Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us this morning for our panel on the label on it, protecting IoT by empowering consumers. IoT cybersecurity labeling is an important topic. At RSA, we'll talk a lot about what industry can do, what governments can do to improve cybersecurity. But I think we do not talk enough about how we can empower consumers to improve their cybersecurity. So how can we empower consumers to make informed decisions about their cybersecurity? And I think IoT labeling is one important conversation that can make that difference. So in this session, we talk about IoT cybersecurity labeling, getting a sense where this conversation is from industry and government, as well as kind of how we move this conversation forward to help consumer protect their cybersecurity. With me here are Henry Kuehn from the Cybersecurity Agency of Singapore. He's the Deputy Director of the Cybersecurity Certification Center. On his left, Kat Megas, Cybersecurity for IoT Program Manager at NIST. And on my very left, Ravi Sharma, Business Manager, Cybersecurity with Underwriters Lab. Thank you so much for being here with me today. So just to get started, as a short round of introduction on the topic, so what are those IoT labels and why are they so important, Henry?
All right, thank you. So I am Henry from Cybersecurity Agency of Singapore. It's great to be here. So I think cybersecurity is, of course, important as we progress along digitalization, especially with the pandemic, where we can kind of see more work from home getting more common, and smartphone devices getting proliferated in the household. And that's something that we should be worried about, in the sense that we have seen so much of cyber attacks relating to IoT devices, and that's where we felt that we should do something about it. And one of the ways that we think that is, rather than always work on the manufacturer side, how about let's try on working on the consumer aspects, on empowering consumer, pretty much like the energy labeling scheme. So that's where we actually got our inspiration from. So nowadays, if you want to buy a fridge, you buy an air conditioner, it's pretty much second nature that any consumer will just look at the energy label and kind of make some informed decision. So how do you translate that into
IoT devices as well, by giving consumer the ability to kind of decide what is something that's acceptable from them in terms of risk, and using that label as a form of communicating this information to them.
Thank you, Henry. This was very comprehensive. Kat?
So I think Henry, I think, covered kind of the range of why it's important to talk about IoT labels, but maybe I can just break down a little bit by what we mean by label. So when we say label, I think there's three parts to the label. There's the actual label that is what is on the product, what is on the device. That can be digital, that can be something that's actually physically on the product and on the box. Then the second part of it, though, is what is the device actually doing, or what is the product actually, what are the criteria that the product's meeting to actually earn or be able to put the label on the product, which at NIST we kind of call the criteria. And then the third part of it is, how do you actually demonstrate, or how does the manufacturer or the product owner, how do they actually prove, or how do they actually attest to the fact that they are actually doing and meeting all the criteria? So when we talk about labels, it's really talking about all three of those aspects, because it really is about trust in the label. So how can you ensure that when you do start putting a label on things, the individual can trust what it is that the label's communicating to them?
Thank you, Kat. Ravi?
Sure. So I think Kate put it very nicely that it's all about trust at the end of the day. Because if we talk about consumers who are out there who understand security, for them, it is sort of an assurance that the device has gone through some level of security checks before getting into the hands of consumers. And for the consumers who do not aware or who are not aware about the security, for them, it's giving that assurance, or it's educating them, it's empowering them. That's what our topic is about. It's empowering them that what the device is about. And if they're going to install one of those devices, it could be a CCTV camera, it could be a smart switch, any of the home appliances, It can give them assurance that, yeah, they're going to be safe. There are not going to be any data breaches or any kind of password compromises and anything like that. And one more thing I want to call out, that being in this industry for over a decade, still when I get any of the smart devices, there's always a this thought into the mind that can I reuse one of my other passwords? Can I store my payment information in one of the voice recognition devices? So even though being in this industry for over a decade, there's still that sense of doubt is there, and I think that kind of empowerment is what Label brings. So yeah.
Perfect. Thank you, Ravi. What I would like to do next is kind of dive a little bit deeper into where some of those initiatives are, and starting with Kat, your agency was mandated to work on labeling. Kind of, maybe you can talk a little bit more about what prompted that and where this journey is at this point.
Great. So I think Henry said it very well. I think we recognize that there is a challenge with IoT devices. I do think that the marketplace overall has a wide range of products. There are some products that are doing very well when it comes to cybersecurity. There are some products that could maybe improve the type of cybersecurity features or capabilities that they offer. So it is about empowering the consumer, but it is also about empowering both the market and those organizations that are actually offering a better product to be able to differentiate themselves. And it's also about informing the consumer so that they can actually start building demand for products that provide better levels of cybersecurity. So, I think that was the motivation. Executive Order 14028 was the executive order that, amongst many things that NIST was tasked with, it was looking at this issue around cybersecurity labels. To break it down, we did not look only at cybersecurity labels for IoT products. We also looked at cybersecurity labels for software products. But I'm just going to focus today on the IoT aspects of that. So as part of the executive order, we were directed to develop criteria. So the criteria, again, going back to kind of my opening statement, was what is it that we would be asking the IoT device manufacturer or producer to actually to earn the IoT device. In developing that, NIST went through a couple of workshops. We built on existing documentation and publications that we had. If you're not familiar with NIST, we are part of the Department of Commerce. We've been working on the IoT cybersecurity effort for a while. We have a publication called the Core Baseline. One of the things we heard very early on from the stakeholders was fragmentation is going to be a big challenge. So NIST, whatever you do, please avoid fragmentation. So in order to avoid fragmentation, we started with what we call the core baseline, looking across all the different markets, regardless of whether it was industrial or federal government or whether we were looking at consumer. We attempted to identify what we saw kind of as a common or a core baseline. Again, there's always going to be edge cases. What we did try to do is identify where there seemed to be general consensus on the core baseline. So in order to develop the criteria, we started with the core baseline. We did do a scan across both international efforts. We looked at things like Singapore's effort and other efforts around the globe. We also looked at domestic and internally. We looked at what was being produced as far as standards go. And we took the core baseline and we adapted it, listening to stakeholders through public workshops, and we published our criteria in February of this year. As part of publishing the criteria for the IoT device, we also made recommendations with respect to what an IoT labeling scheme or program would need to have in place around certification. Our recommendation, based on stakeholder input, that any scheme going forward for the U.S. should allow for both a manufacturer's self-declaration of conformity as well as third party. And then when it came to the issue of the label, our recommendation was, without doing any market testing, of course, but based on stakeholder input, our recommendation was it should be a binary label. I'm not sure if we're planning on talking about it or if any of my colleagues are. There are different types of labels. There's the nutritional label, which is kind of what you're used to seeing on, food packaging. There's the, HR approach, there are different approaches. We felt that the most reasonable approach for consumers, given where we are today, the world changes and the world evolves, but given where we are today, was a binary label, something that says, yes, this product does meet the core baseline, or this product does meet the baseline, or it does not. Again, this is a voluntary effort. We're not looking at anything that would be mandatory at this point in time. So we've delivered our report that summarized what we learned throughout the pilot. I'm happy to share those insights throughout the rest of the discussion. But I'm looking forward to hearing what my colleagues have to say as well.
Perfect. Thank you, Kat. I think this was, also again, congratulations to, I think, those very robust efforts and conversations during this preparatory phase to get where you are right now. So now we heard from the US what the US is doing, kind of like towards potentially a labeling scheme in the US, right? And now I'd love to go to Henry and kind of like to actually talk about Singapore's effort there. So in the US, we're still talking about labels. In the US, we're talking about labels. Singapore actually has labels, and I'm curious, how did that go? What was the reaction from industry when you came up with that? And you were one of the first ones. Finland is kind of the first mover there, right? We talked about that. But we're the first ones. I'm curious about your lessons learned and experience so far.
Right. So we had this concept of having a labeling scheme for IoT, I think, back in 2018. So that was quite early, and essentially there was no reference model for us to follow. So we, at that point, we really don't know how a labeling scheme would look like. Whether should it be a binary scheme, whether should it be a multi-level scheme, and even when we decided to be a multi-level scheme, how should we then, how many levels should we have? Should it be 4, should it be 5, 10? And how do we fit in each level? Or what are the criteria for each of the levels? How to make, or should we have it based on manufacturer self-declaration or third-party assessment? Should we also kind of, how do we kind of manage the cost for manufacturers, but at the same time obtain a reasonable assurance for the consumer? So those were really some of the big questions that we had in the past, and that's where we felt it's helpful to kind of speak with partners internationally as well to learn about what their thoughts are and how we could probably piece together a labeling scheme that we think is probably suitable. We don't have the right answer at that point, and pretty much we just try it out. I think, and that's something that's in a way possible, given Singapore is actually a very small country. It's easier to kind of try out some of this initiative to test out what the response are, whether something is useful for the consumer as well. So a year and a half, a bit more since our launch, we are quite, in a way, quite glad that we have now about 150 labeled products, both available in online stores and physical stores, with another 100 more of applications being processed currently. So I mean, compared to the billions of IoT, 250, 300 is not a big number, but it's kind of assuring for us to know that it's, you know, pretty much a good start at this point in time. And I think that's where we are continuing our efforts in terms of trying to do outreach, or engaging the manufacturers and also the consumer themselves. So we are glad that last year we have also signed a mutual recognition arrangement with Finland, so that now both labels issued in Finland and Singapore are mutually recognized. And in fact, manufacturers could obtain two labels from Finland and Singapore with a single process. And I think that helps with engaging manufacturers, knowing that their products, when they go through a labeling program, it's not going to be just recognized in one market, but allows them to also export to and access additional markets. I think that's something that's very helpful. So increasingly, we have also kind of glad to kind of get feedbacks from manufacturers that when they have this label, they see actually an increase in terms of sales inquiries by about 30%. So I think that is pretty much helpful, and they see the values of it. And we are also now starting to see more manufacturers who have earlier applied for level one, increasingly kind of applied for higher levels. So nudging them towards developing more secure products bit by bit, and that's something that's again reassuring for us. So now what happens is we do observe that there are generally some, manufacturers who are well experienced, they have the resources to be able to invest into cybersecurity, has a dedicated team, But beyond that, there's an even larger pool of manufacturers who may not have this expertise in terms of building cybersecurity or have the knowledge of cybersecurity. So for example, if it's going to be a smart teddy bears or smart washing machine, rice cooker, those products has traditionally no relevance to cybersecurity. And that becomes challenging for them to even consider and think about how to build cybersecurity, especially from scratch. And now we try to move a bit upstream as well on targeting on the hardware manufacturers, on having this hardware platform, what we call CLS ready, going through a certification program to get this hardware platforms kind of certified, so that subsequent manufacturers of teddy bears could then leverage on this secure hardware platform to develop more secure teddy bears in a sense. And that's something that we're working on currently.
We're definitely looking forward to those secure teddy bears. I think it was really helpful to understand how Singapore and the US kind of like have similarities in their approaches, but also kind of differences, and kind of like I think the future will show how we do this. I think there's a huge learning curve ahead in order to do that. But I think also in this conversation, at least in the cybersecurity conversation, it's always this question, what should the private industry do versus what should governments do? And so now turning to Ravi and see kind of like, what is Underwriters Lab doing there and how does your rating system work?
Sure, so before I get to that question, Henry talked about that 200, 300 devices, it's not a huge number, but I actually want to call out one of the examples that today, one of our partners, one of our customers is GE, and we actually certified two or three of their IoT components. And using those three IoT components, they actually cover 300 different series of devices. So 300 could be a small number when we look at the overall industry or the ecosystem, but I think if you're certifying one or the other IoT components, we're actually providing a coverage of almost to 1 million devices. So I think that's very important, because sometimes when we look at consumer devices, we only see one device as the device in its whole, but we need to understand that there is a connected component that goes into each of those devices and those series of devices. And and when it comes to UL, I think one thing that we need to understand, we act as an independent certification body, and in order to help our partners during this compliance journey, what we are seeing is what Kate talked about is fragmentation in the market. When we look at the markets, like when we talk about Europe, where we have attestations for HCE and 303645, now there is a new directive in place, Radio Equipment Directive. We also talk about DLC, Digital Light Consortium. So what do we do with such kind of a fragmented market, and how do we actually guide and handhold our partners throughout this journey? Because we all know security is a process. It's not just a milestone, right? It's an ongoing process. So in that case, we have UL MCV 1376 in place. It's a market claim verification methodology. And what we do is that whenever we see such kind of fragmentations in the market, we try to map it to, because at the end of the day, it's all about security requirements. There are certain requirements under 303645, under DLC, under RED, under CLS. So all these requirements are there. So it's really about mapping those requirements. And when we talk about labeling, like a market claim verification, there are two types of needs which we see from our consumers or from our customers. One is, how do we get that compliance, that assurance done? And number two, from a market positioning, from a business positioning, how do we get a label on it to educate the end consumer? And that's where UL 1376 plays a significant role, because it sorts of cover a lot of your compliance requirements through different levels, of course, depending upon your device classification. Because of course, if it is a teddy bear, the complexity of the security requirements is going to be very different versus if it is a CCTV camera or any other device. So that's what it is. And second, of course, NIST criteria is going to set a very significant milestone in this journey. And it is all about collaboration. I mean, we are one of the approved labs under Cybersecurity Agency of Singapore for their labeling scheme. We do certify devices. I think one of them is Google Nest as well. So I think that's what it is all about. Now, I just wanna call out one more point related to fragmentation. It's not just about consumer devices. when we look at some of the other industries, some of the other connected industries like industrial, when we talk about medical devices, there are so many other standards that are there out. Recently, one of the industrial standard 62443, it is declared as a horizontal standard by IECE. So what do we do in that case? The questions, the complexity comes in when they start asking questions that, okay, device is a device that we're going to get certified, but what about the cloud backend? What about the environment where it is going to get integrated with? So I think it's very important that, like what Henry mentioned, that we need to shift left when it comes to cybersecurity and get start to involve early in the stages of product development lifecycle in order to really bring that education, that awareness in the market, not only for the end consumers, but for the product manufacturers. So I think that's one of the things that is very, very important from my perspective.
Thank you, Ravi. This was also very comprehensive. Thinking about, since we are in many places still in the early stages, since we want to empower consumers to make the right cybersecurity decisions, we need to raise awareness and drive adoption. And I think that's kind of, it seems a very critical component and an expensive component to actually get people and consumers enrolled in order to do that. And I was curious, getting started in the beginning is very critical. So Henry, can you tell us a little bit more about how Singapore has been doing that? And maybe do you have like some secrets you can share about how what others can learn from that?
Well, indeed, in terms of consumer awareness and manufacturers' engagement, those are really big topics and not easy one. So to a certain extent, it's again one of the chicken and egg situation whereby if we go about trying to educate consumer that you should buy labeled products, and the challenge is there isn't any right at the beginning. So how can we then pass that message that buying labeled product is good for you when there isn't any labeled products? And at the early stage, when we engage the manufacturers that you should get your products labeled, though many of the manufacturers will often adopt a wait and see approach, looking whether there's really some demands from the consumer or whether their competitors are moving. So that was the difficult start right at the beginning, that it is pretty much we have to decide who to go after to. And I think that's where we still have to kind of leverage on different mechanisms to kind of do this outreach. So we run several stories with the media to kind of at least spread the awareness, letting public know about the existence of such a scheme, even though there isn't any products yet. And then that's where we also start also a bit more targeted at the smaller manufacturers who are pretty much more receptive into adopting a label, especially if the cost to them is low. And that's where they see the potential of benefits of the label could be useful and that help get some of the initial products going onto the market. And what we did also especially is to spread awareness is what we have this thing called a little token for contact tracing. So during the pandemic, what we need to do is to have effective contact tracing. And that's where the government actually issued a Trace Together token to the residents of Singapore to help with the contact tracing effort. At that early time, there was initial concern whether the token itself is tracking individuals, whether is it storing data securely, whether is it transmitting personal information back to server or sort. So what we did was also to get that token through the cybersecurity labeling program at level 4, in fact. So it get tested by a third party approved laboratory to kind of make sure that while there's no like kind of GPS to track individuals, there's no LTE modem to communicate or to kind of transfer information. The Bluetooth communication are pretty much secure. Data are stored securely. They've been done side channel analysis to see whether the leak keys could be leaked. And eventually that get a little kind of sticker onto the token and issued to the residents. So in that sense, technically, all residents in Singapore has a device that is a cybersecurity label scheme label. So that kind of give them also assurance. So following that, they were quite happy with that token and using that as well. But at the same time, it lets them recognize how a label will look like, and hopefully that kind of builds some subconscious awareness into it.
And I think if I may add to that, I think it was also interesting and important to see in the beginning, you start, I think many devices in the beginning were self-certification, were kind of like a much lower barrier of entry, and you know, industry takes up on that. And I think that was an important part to that. And now you see, kind of like in the later iterations, you see many more bigger players coming in that actually go directly for the highest level of certification, because if you're already doing this, why don't we go in full and go for that?
Yeah, perhaps just add in a few more. So we do observe that smaller manufacturers tend to prefer the level one, level two based on self-declaration, because partly the criteria of is lower, the bar is not that high, it's achievable, and yet the cost is pretty low in a sense, it's based on self-declaration. Whereas bigger brands, manufacturers who has the resources and expertise will often go straight for level four as a means of market differentiation for their products as well. So that's a general trend that actually we observed.
Yeah, so I just want to add one more point. So just to bring this conversation a little bit back to the States, I think when we talk about these small players or tier ones or tier two, tier threes, one of the trend that we observe, we are observing here in the US, that a lot of tier one US retailers, they're also trying to establish or create sort of their own baseline security framework to have it for their suppliers to be able to sell those devices. So all the devices that we see off the shelves on all the big retailer stores, they are trying to come up with some kind of a baseline security assurance program. Of course, because of absence of a single standard that covers pretty much all the requirements. So that's where they're establishing this baseline program, which they can ask their suppliers to comply with before having them to sell their devices on their stores or on the online commerce. So I think that's a very important trend that we need to take a look at, that even though there are all sorts of these security rating programs, there are standards, there are compliance mandates and everything, but at the end of the day, when it comes to the end suppliers, if something goes wrong with the device, I think it's not gonna be the suppliers who are gonna get blamed for or questioned for, but it's gonna be the entity who's actually responsible for taking those devices to the market. So it's very important that when we talk about such kind of baseline programs, it's not just for the sake of that, yeah, we have done our self-attestation and we have followed some of the baseline requirements, but it is also about that we're really focusing on the complexity and bringing that assurance in order to ensure that depending upon the device capabilities, whether it is a Bluetooth device or a Wi-Fi device or a network integrated device, in order to ensure that we cover all sorts of like complex security requirements as part of this assurance program. So I just want to add that.
Perfect, thank you. I just want to quickly follow up on a related question with you to get a better sense how adoption looks like from an industry perspective. In our preparations to this panel, we talked about that, and you were sharing that, you know, it's not only in the consumer market that requests from industries coming about labels, but you see that in industrials, medical, and automotive, which is kind of outside of kind of what we're talking about today, the consumer market. So can you share a bit more about that and maybe how this relates with adoption overall of labels, what you see in industry?
Sure. Yeah, thanks. I think that's a very interesting question. So today when we look at, even though we call it as a consumer IoT, I think everything is IoT, whether it is an industrial, whether it is automotive, wherever there is some kind of a network connection, it all categorizes under IoT. And that's why we are positioning sort of it kind of like a baseline IoT. Now, when we look at some of the some of our industrial partners or automotive partners, often they come to us and they go through the compliance certifications under one or the other standards, but they also ask for that, oh, for our market positioning, can we actually get some kind of a label? Can we go through your security rating program to get that market claim verification and put a label on it? So definitely there is a trend that, because when we look at sort of other sectors like industrial, like medical, the devices where we have a lot of back-end connectivity with cloud, with bigger network integrations, and if those devices are getting installed in the facilities like Moscone Center, all the CCTV cameras and everything, are you gonna categorize it as a consumer device? Maybe yes, maybe no. So because it is a part of a bigger implementation, and that's where It's not just about the compliance of the security assurance, but from a business perspective, from a marketing perspective, in order to connect to the end consumer, that's where also label plays a very, very important role. And I often say that when we talk about B2C model, there is going to be always that learning curve. There is always going to be a need for empowerment of the end consumers, whether it is an IoT product or anything else. So that's the trend that we are seeing.
Thank you so much. Before we kind of open up for questioning the audience, I want to go back to you, Kat. And I think in some of the conversation we saw, I mean, this is like the, I'm trying to be the cheerleader here for panel, for labels. I think it says something important, not about the labels itself, but having this conversation about empowering consumer and cybersecurity. But the kind of like in your conversations with regards to preparing the pilot, you kind of share that there are definitely kind of really difficult challenges ahead, and it's not entirely clear where that journey is going.
Absolutely, yes. We are still very early in the process. And before I even go into this, I do kind of want to clarify, NIST does not intend to stand up an IoT product cybersecurity labeling program. What we did do is we made some recommendations, we conducted the pilot, we delivered a report to the White House. That report is published, anybody can go look at it, where we kind of summarize our findings. And there are still, I think, at least for the US, I think there is still a journey ahead of us. I think there were lots of topics that were covered on today. I was listening and I wish I'd had my notebook because my memory is terrible to touch on them, but absolutely, consumer awareness, that is a huge issue. It's a large undertaking. How do we actually empower the consumer to recognize the label, have the label have a brand associated with it, create the demand for the label? That's a huge undertaking, and one of the things we heard is it's unclear whether any single organization in private sector could really undertake that large a task. There are other issues that still remain open. Liability, that is a question that still remains kind of out there. If I am a producer of a device and if this is a voluntary effort, it's not mandated, am I potentially taking on liability by adopting a label? And if I am perhaps one of the organizations, such as a certification body or otherwise, if I am the organization that is managing the label process, which is, it's not just the act of putting a label on something, there is the monitoring that has to occur, the market surveillance. You have to ensure that the labels that are out there are not counterfeit, or that if something changes with respect to that product, what is the life cycle of the label? So what is the liability that any organization that takes that on? Then of course there is the underlying criteria. We heard from our stakeholders, they would like us to continue to iterate with our stakeholders on those criteria, because we did make some pivots in our criteria. One thing is, somebody mentioned, I think you mentioned the product, and looking at things like the cloud and the other components. So traditionally, we had focused very much on the device and on the security of the device. But as we started looking at the consumer and we started thinking about an industrial customer potentially can understand there's different components to this IoT product, there's the cloud, there are requirements I have as an organization that I may pass down to my supplier when it comes to the cloud. However, when you look at your average consumer, they see a label on a box, they don't necessarily understand that this label is only specific to the device that's in the box. So we started exploring the topic of how do we actually define the product? Does the product include cloud components? Does the product include the mobile app that controls the IoT device? So I think this is an area that I think our stakeholders really want us to continue to iterate on beyond the initial recommendations that we made. One thing we did do as well is the S in NIST stands for standards. So what we did is we articulated outcomes. When we talk about criteria, we said these are the outcomes. These are the cybersecurity outcomes that we feel the product should achieve. We think that there are multiple ways to achieve those outcomes, as there should be, because your perhaps your connected dishwasher is going to perhaps have a different way to achieve those outcomes than your connected front door lock or your smart thermostat. And that's the role we see that standards are going to play. We think there needs to be a marketplace of standards that gives manufacturers flexibility to choose the standard that is correct and appropriate for them and suited to their maturity, suited to their organization, suited to the type of product in order to meet those outcomes. So we still think that there's a way to go until the market actually has all those standards in place. So we are going to continue to iterate. We are planning a public workshop later this month, so I don't know if it's really later this summer, where we do plan on sitting and continuing to talk to stakeholders and iterating on some of those ideas that we introduced as part of the consumer label.
Perfect, thank you so much. Now I would like to open up the floor if you have any questions for the panel, statements, your views around how we can help drive consumer cybersecurity. The microphones are in the middle there. You have the first question. Please go close enough to the microphone, I was told, to make sure we can hear you loud and clearly. Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate the panel talk. Very interesting. My question is for Henry. Kat just mentioned the role of the cloud services and web app or other aspects of the product. When the consumer gets the product, they're going to be using all of these features, mm-hmm. including the physical hardware. How did Singapore deal with this situation?
All right, thank you for the questions. So as of now, so we are more focused on the product itself to make sure that the product at least meets certain baseline requirement and is being tested that the product itself is not really vulnerable to any vulnerabilities. So there are at different levels, depending on the levels itself, some aspects of testing that involves looking at how the product potentially authenticates back to cloud services, or especially at level 3, we also look at the companion mobile application on how it actually controls the product device itself. But as of now, we don't really kind of have specific kind of criteria relating to the backend services. We are all constantly kind of evolving the scheme as well, and well, as when it's matured, at some point in time, we might also incorporate. And I think we need to rely on CAD to produce the standards to help us achieve that.
And actually, that segues into, if I may, a follow-up question for Ravi. The concept of UL testing cloud services, how does that fit in your current business or future business?
Yeah, sure. So in the current business, normally, as Henry also mentioned, that it is cloud security requirements are not covered as part of any of the standards, specifically when we talk about consumer IoT. But we do perform like some kind of a custom testing, whether it is a pen testing or fuzzing or anything like that across the cloud backend. That is more of a custom testing outside of the standard that we perform in the current business when we receive any kind of a device with a cloud backend. But there are already in the works for the future as part of these standards, whether we talk about the European standards or any of the directives, there are already, it is a work in progress where we sort of starting to look at the cloud requirements and make it part of the standards in the future. So it's not like we are defining the standards, but we are contributing towards the industry bodies like NIST and others, where we could bring up the challenges with the cloud backend and start to include some of those requirements as part of the base security assurance programs.
Very good, thank you. So it sounds like NIST and the United States don't have a label yet, but when we do, it will actually include a little bit more than just the device, and we see that to get there. I want to recommend the work of the Cloud Security Alliance, by the way, in this context.
Great.
We've been talking with them about this particular problem. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for the question. Any other questions from the audience?
IoT devices. There are a lot of compromise made in the recent do edge computing, edge server installed through which they can do IoT security part. But whereas they are not in the cloud, you know, some of the devices, like you know, homemade devices, now we are talking about artificial intelligence and other things which comes to IoT. So how that can be implemented if it is not in cloud, that aspect, you know, any of the panelists do that, any insight you want to give us?
Okay.
So
yeah.
To add to the point, you know, I am in home. I try to make automate my whole all homemade devices. For me, how to I make? I am not in the cloud. It's not in the cloud. How I can make sure my devices are not get compromised? What are the things? And actually, so this is like you know, like you guys have discussed about all the policies and other things. What is the consequences of? The person who is in, you know, running a sponsor or running in home, you know, extra effort or money need to be spent to make sure the devices are not, you know, to comply to the requirement, whatever 1402, whatever.
Yeah, so normally if, I think that's what we were talking about when we look at the consumer devices, that's what the main focus is, that today the requirements do not talk about any of the cloud backend or any of the mobile connectivity sort of in scope. So when we talk about consumer devices, it is really about testing that specific device. Now, if you look at some of the regulations that are out there, I think I named some of them. We talked about RED, we talked about DLC, we talked about 303.645. We're going to soon have a NIST criteria published. We talked about CSA. So all these schemes, all these regulations, depending upon where the device is going to get implemented, it goes through, even though some of them are mandates, some of them are not. We still recommend that it goes through some kind of a baseline security assurance program, and that's how at the end of the day you get a label on it. But if you talk about bigger industries, like some of the examples you talked about, those industries, as soon as your device implementation or the environment where it's going to be installed and changes from a smart building to a smart home to an industrial plant, the underlying standard, underlying requirements changes. And that's where one of the standard I could think of is IEC 62443, which is more for Industry 4.0 standard. So whenever we are talking about industrial IoT devices that gets installed under the such a big manufacturing plants, there are other standards that underlie the, that define the requirements for such kind of devices that are going to get installed onto these kind of like bigger manufacturing plants with or without the cloud backend. Now, I understand that cloud backend is one of the, I would say, trend that's upcoming more and more. There are no such standards, not that I could recall of, that talks about cloud requirements so far. But yeah, there are solutions out there. I mean, I myself visited quite a few booths where they were talking about cloud security. They were talking about having a cloud backend. So there are some custom security requirements and techniques that talks about securing your cloud backend versus securing your device without the cloud backend.
I was going to ask Ravi, when it comes to medical devices, because I believe UL does quite a bit of work when it comes to connected medical devices, do they include the back end in?
They do.
Am I allowed to ask panelists questions?
No, that's thank you for that question. So for the medical devices, UL has a specific standard, UL 2900. That actually talks about the inclusion of medical devices. Now, again, when it comes to the back end, it does not include the cloud backend, just to clarify that, yeah. It only talks about the device testing itself. However, it talks about the extensive testing of fuzzing, of vulnerability management, of risk management, and all of that. But now, as I answer to one of the gentlemen there, that there is a work in progress where we are starting to include the requirements for the cloud as part of one of the standards. But today, the answer is no, yeah.
What I think is really interesting how this is getting broader and broader, right? Kind of like the original idea around the label where it started off and how we can actually empower consumers with for cybersecurity. I think that's where we started with, right? With the idea that if we get a label out there, industry invests in cybersecurity and those who do can benefit from that by, you know, there are studies at least out there that indicate that consumers are willing to pay for cybersecurity. And so I think that's where the labels come in. This is becoming a more and more complex environment. We are talking about cloud services, how are those different components integrated. And I think while this is very important, I think from the consumer perspective, this gets, again, kind of obscure. I'm not sure if the normal consumer understands that. I think it's important that we do not signal security with a label where there is not, right, because of other components are being part of that and kind of affect the risk calculation and what it means for cybersecurity. So I think we need to really think hard about the broader environment, all those components, including third parties that come in there, that I think even the integrator of a product might not always know how secure some of those services are. I think it's a real big problem. I think at the same time, we need to have something to talk to consumer about that, right? Kind of think hard about establishing that trust. I see there's one more question. Would you mind allowing the gentleman behind you to ask a question?
Yes, sure.
Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot, and thanks for this very good talk and also the sharing this information. I have a question about integrating the consumer, because I think it's very important, and especially in Germany, we like to see the Singaporean concept or think about to implement this also, but to involve the customer, I think it's also somehow important to educate him, because it's something different than a new debate or something like this. The amount of calorie is always the same in a product, but security is a moving target. So it might be that if it's a physical product, you have now a label on it, but tomorrow it's not any more valid. So the customer needs to learn how to understand this kind of label. What are the plans for integrating the customer into this game?
Right, perhaps I can take that question in terms of educating the consumer. It is an important topic, and we think that this is going to be a long journey. It's not going to happen tomorrow that suddenly everyone wakes up and becomes cybersecurity conscious. It's going to take perhaps even a decade or so. And what we are actually doing now as well is also to incorporate cybersecurity into the kind of high school or secondary school's syllabus in terms of educating them, or both in terms of recognizing the label or having developed cybersecurity conscious. And frankly, I think most of us are looking at the average age clock, I think we are not digital natives. We don't grow up in a digital world. So in a sense, especially, I think, in the Asia culture, we kind of learn from parents in the past, that the parents would tell us, do not talk to strangers, do not kind of like follow someone away. But when it comes to digital, it appears to be in the reverse direction. It is now today the younger children teaching their parents about cybersecurity. And as we observe from some of the other programs in terms of recycling, we see that it is like the children that kind of educates the parents, why aren't you recycling? Why aren't you kind of trying to do that? And that's where we try to now also focus more on the youngs, given that they eventually grow up with the spending power, and they're the ones going to be purchasing smart devices. They're the ones that going to be getting married, building their new homes full of all these smart devices. And that's where we have also collaboration with our other government agencies, like, for example, having roadshows, having targeted groups in terms of newlyweds. So when they get married, they're likely going to buy new devices for their home. So we work with our housing agency as well to kind of start educating cybersecurity for them. And as I mentioned, it's going to be a very, very long journey.
And in a lot of, just one more point, in a lot of cases, we also have some surveillance programs in place where we actually perform the surveillance of the devices on a yearly basis, on a half yearly basis, just to take a look if there were any sort of like patches that been installed, any updates that's been installed, in order to ensure if it needs to go through some kind of a evaluation all over again from a security perspective. So that's also there in place. Thank you.
Ravi, Kat, Henry, thank you so much. We come to an end. It was a pleasure to have you here for this panel. Again, my name is Andreas Kuehn. I'm with the Observer Research Foundation America, a Washington, D.C.-based think tank. It was great to be here with you. I think there's much more we can talk about. I'm looking forward to our next conversation. And thank you for everyone for being here.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.